Welcome to the Headless Professor series. Today we're talking about research methods in psychology, different ways that we can observe the relationship between a stimulus, an organism, and a response. The oldest research technique in psychology is introspection. That means looking within, reflecting upon one's own thoughts, emotions, and actions. Introspection has been around for a long time, and indeed it was still the principal research technique of such great pioneers in the field of psychology as Wilhelm Wundt and William James toward the end of the 19th century. There are several problems, though, with introspection. The obvious one is that we have a pretty small sample size of n equals 1. I can only introspect on one person, myself. You can only introspect on one person, yourself. So the small sample size is one limitation. Another is that the observer is going to be somewhat biased. That's because the observer is the observed. I can only introspect on myself. And I might have a reason for looking at myself in a favorable fashion. Furthermore, when I think about my thoughts, I'm also generating more thoughts. My observation contaminates what I am observing. So, John Watson clearly rejected introspection. He considered it insufficiently scientific. I would not be so harsh in my judgment of introspection, but I will agree that it is at best a starting point. It can help us generate some hypotheses, but it cannot confirm hypotheses. Introspection really proves nothing. Let's go on to another research technique used by psychologists, the case study. In some situations, these are little more than anecdotes or vignettes, but when used properly, they can be full-fledged biographies or very thorough clinical case studies. The case study shares many problems along with introspection. There's that small sample size again, n equals 1. And then there's the other issue of the bias of the observer. People with different clinical or theoretical frameworks may see different things in the same clinical case. So, case studies really prove nothing either. But they are useful because they often illustrate a certain point, such as a complex interaction of different variables. Case studies can also illustrate how to do a certain kind of diagnostic procedure or a certain kind of therapeutic intervention. Another research technique used in psychology is a survey. And when I say a survey, what I mean is a large sample investigation where we have numerous participants. The variables are also quantified to measure them more objectively and precisely. Now, one way of doing a survey is by having a questionnaire that many individuals will fill out. But there are other ways, easier ways, of doing surveys. Perhaps we already have data in archives, such as patient records, student records, or employment records. These archives may also exist on websites and describe the traffic of different individuals. The data mining potential of the World Wide Web could also use such things as tracking cookies. We can also do a simple field count where we go to a public place and simply observe people's behavior at shopping malls or video game parlors or other kinds of areas. Surveys can give us correlations, But because we really don't manipulate any independent variables, we are often left with a question about the nature of the causal relationship. We don't know if two variables are related because one causes the other, or perhaps the relationship is spurious, with both variables being collateral effects of some other underlying cause. The best research technique for determining causation is the experiment. The experiment takes an independent variable and intentionally manipulates that variable. One of the easiest ways of doing this is by randomly assigning each of the subjects in the sample into one of two different groups, an experimental group and a control group. Then we treat those two groups differently, perhaps with different kinds of training or different kinds of treatment. Then we observe any changes in the outcome variable, and then we can attribute those differences to the independent variable that was manipulated. That is why experiments are the best ways to verify a cause and effect relationship between variables. If you have any comments, contact me, brink@usa.com.